Thank you very much, Steve. Can you hear me okay in the back? Okay, that's great. It's important that you can hear me. I lost my hearing 18 years ago. I hear with an amazing technology today called the cochlear implant. Now, during the discussion, I have a pretty good chance of being able to understand your question. I might have to ask you to repeat it or have Steve come down and help me field the questions, but we should be in pretty good shape. You know, living in this world of hearing impaired has its moments. I actually received my cochlear implant surgery here at University of Michigan Hospital. My audiologist is based here, and I was getting a checkup recently and walked out with two other patients, and the woman next to me happened to say, "Isn't it windy?" And the guy next to her said, "No, it's Thursday." And I said, "So am I. Let's go get a beer." And, you know, it really does have its moments when you live in that world. What I'm going to do is talk about transforming mobility. Now, I know you've heard about alternative energy, you've heard about electric vehicles and fuel cell vehicles, probably haven't talked about what I consider to be the most important transformational mobility technology I will have ever touched in my career and will probably be defining in your career, and that's autonomous or driverless vehicles. And so part of the future of the mobility that we're going to get into today is how does that inevitability, and I do believe it's inevitable, provide new opportunities for society, new opportunities for consumers, and new opportunity for businesses. But first, I think it's important to put this in a historical context. In 1886, Carl Benz invented the first gasoline-powered automobile. He received the patent for that. And it was a phenomenal invention. But what's interesting about that is how it's evolved from that date until where we are today. In fact, I think what you can conclude is that the fundamental design DNA of what Benz invented is still pretty much the same design DNA of an automobile. Yes, we've made it better. We've done things like adding steering wheels and speedometers and automatic starters. We've added brake pedals and power steering and air conditioning and automatic transmissions. Interestingly, when we first started collecting data on highway fatalities in the United States in 1949, 7.3 people were dying per 100 million miles traveled. I'll show you where that has landed over up to today's point in just a minute, but that certainly is a huge number. So you began to see a number of safety innovations enter into the automobile, the seat belt, anti-lock brakes, airbags. All of these tend to be more dependent on electronic controls, then GPS enters in. So now we can begin to start thinking about where are all these vehicles located and when. Stability control, it was after seatbelts the most important safety innovation that we've seen in the auto industry, but it's taking some of the driving away from the driver. When the car gets in circumstances that it's smarter to handle than the driver can handle, the car takes over. In fact, there's a very interesting blog in Wall Street Journal today by Joe White. He's talking about the inevitability of driverless cars by 2025, but more importantly are the comments being made by David Strickland, who's the head of the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, on the causes of accidents. And he attributes most severe accidents still are being caused by human error. Some of the facts are stunning in terms of how many times a vehicle runs into something and the brake hasn't even been touched by the driver. So safety and stability control and electronic data started to come in. We also began to see the introduction of modern electric vehicles in 1996 with the EV1. The Prius entered the market in 1997 as a hybrid. Then we had adaptive cruise control, all-speed adaptive cruise control and lane keeping systems. And impressively, through good systems engineering on all fronts, better cars, better roads, better traffic laws, better enforcement of those laws, we now have that fatality rate down to 1.1 per 100 million miles traveled, a factor of 7 improvement, which is very, very encouraging to see what we can do. But that's all been evolutionary change. And bottom line on this chart, though, is what's going on with driverless vehicles. In 2004, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency had a competition for self-driving cars through the desert. 2007, they said, we'd like to do another one in urban areas. And since then, Google has now accomplished nearly 500,000 miles on public roads of cars literally driving themselves. So we're beginning that real learning process with self-driving technology. So it's been an interesting history. But that historical DNA of the car, mechanically driven with a combustion engine, oil-based fuel, mechanical and hydraulic controls, vehicles operating pretty much on a standalone basis, they're personally owned, human operated, and general purpose. That's pretty much the kind of cars that Benz and Ford popularized and the kinds of cars that we tend to buy and use today. It's not surprising that this machine has had great popularity. In fact, because of the freedom to go where you want to, when you want to, carrying the goods that you want to carry, traveling with the people you want to travel, driving in cities and driving on highways, we end up now with 1 billion automobiles on the world's roadways. If you park those cars end to end and wrap them around the planet, they'll go around about 100 times. So you get a sense, that's a lot of cars and trucks. And along with that are some real serious concerns. Even though in the United States we've made great progress on reducing roadway fatalities, worldwide we're still seeing 1.2 million people dying on roads. That's epidemic in scale, absolutely epidemic. 95% of our energy is miles traveled are dependent on oil. So whether it's a geopolitical concern, an environmental concern, a price volatility concern, that's not a robust position to be in. We have significant traffic delays, land use and cost delays for parking. Even coming here today, I buffered my trip by 30 minutes. I have a little blue sticker that says I can park in special lots, and I still was concerned that I would arrive here and not find a place to park. The environmental impact of CO2 emissions increasing the risk of climate change, and then the infrastructure is aging and costly. So you kind of put all this together and you step back and you say, yeah, there's some compelling benefits, but you really do need to conclude that the automobile road and roadway transportation system, as we've all known it, is likely unsustainable without transformational change. A lot of evolutionary change. Cars are cleaner, safer, more affordable, more fuel efficient. If we continue to think we're going to evolve to solve those challenges, I just don't believe we're going to get there. So we need transformational change. And, you know, the good news around that transformational change is a new design DNA for automobiles has begun to surface. And it's a pretty exciting one. It's electrically driven vehicles with electric motors. This is in addition to the mechanical drive, obviously. Diverse energy sources, and then electronic and digital controls to go with our mechanical and hydraulic. Vehicles that are connected and coordinated rather than operating pretty much on a standalone basis. Shared vehicles, autonomous vehicles, and designs that are actually tailored to how people use their cars, which in most cases are 1- and 2-person trips in areas where top speeds don't exceed 30 or 35 miles an hour. We're going to talk about all of those building blocks for that design transformation. But in looking at innovation throughout my career, what I realize is it's not just technology that brings about transformational change. It's usually that and a big change in the business model underlying industries. And to put that business model opportunity in perspective, today what the auto industry does is it designs and builds and sells vehicles, and then gasoline gets sold and insurance gets sold. In the future, we're seeing people putting business models together where they're selling miles, trips, and experiences. And that's a very interesting change for the industry. And so it's going to be a combination of these innovative business models with this convergence of technology that sets up this new DNA that really makes it possible. And why do I believe in that? Because the business opportunity is extremely compelling. In the United States alone, there's 3 trillion miles being traveled on roadways. Now, if you could just find a way to make a penny a mile, you'd make $30 billion. That's the kind of profitability that Apple has and ExxonMobil has. Anybody say, well, geez, how real is this penny a mile? How real could I do that on every mile? So what if you made 10 cents on just 10% of the miles? You'd still make $30 billion. So I want you to remember that penny, and I want you to remember that 10 cents, because we're going to come back and visit those numbers, and you're going to have to reach your own conclusion based on what I show you, whether you indeed see a business opportunity here in transforming mobility. So let's start with vehicle propulsion and talk about that a bit. And again, I know you've studied this. This is just one slide to try to capture what I take away from this subject. On this side of the chart, we have internal combustion engines, and those are cars that are primarily or nearly 100% mechanical machines. Way over on the other side, we have pure electric vehicles, a plug-in electric vehicle like the Leaf, and fuel cell electric vehicles. I want to emphasize that a fuel cell vehicle is an electric vehicle. And it's a very compelling electric vehicle, quite honestly, because you can refuel with hydrogen much faster than you can recharge a battery. In between, we have mechanically driven vehicles with electrical assist. That's what a hybrid is. And we have plug-in hybrids, which are mechanically driven vehicles with electrical assist. And also we have things like extended range electric vehicles like the Chevy Volt, and that's an electrically driven vehicle with a mechanical assist. So the Volt is an electric car. And when you use up all the electrons stored in the battery, an engine kicks on that runs a generator to make electricity so you can keep driving the car. So you're getting a mechanical assist on an electric car. All of these are important. You'll continue to run into people saying, I know the answer, it shall be a pure plug-in electric vehicle or a zero-emission vehicle, or we're going to go after hybrids. My gosh, in my career alone, I was on the executive committee of U.S. CAR when Clinton was president, and there the idea was hybrids, and we were charged through a program for the next generation of vehicles to do hybrids. President Bush comes along and says, no. The first vehicle driven by a child born today is going to be a fuel cell vehicle, and we're going to go after hydrogen. President Obama comes along and says, no, it's batteries. It's lithium-ion batteries, and we're going to do this, and we're going to have 1 million plug-in electric vehicles on the road by 2015. The fact is, it's all of these. I really want to emphasize that. And there's a lot of commonality because it involves electric motors, power electronics, and controls. And it provides pathways for letting diverse energy enter into the system. And what are those energy pathways? First, the upper box is that mechanical drive that I described, and the lower box is the electrical drive. And notice that the mechanical drive can be fed by gasoline, diesel fuel, compressed natural gas. Also, hydrogen is relevant, and liquid biofuels. Then the electrical drive, that is a little faded, you may not be able to see that, but electricity on hydrogen, and the beauty of this chart is hydrogen can be made from electricity and electricity can be made from hydrogen. And in fact, you can make the hydrogen and electricity from a wide range of primary energy sources. So by getting electrical drive into the mix, we're going to set up a wide range of alternatives for energy pathways into the vehicle. So a lot of people will get hung up on the battery or the fuel cell or the biofuel. What I like to look at is that mix of electrical and mechanical drive from an engineering standpoint. Natural gas is critically important part of this picture. And given your stage in your career and what you're studying, you're in this class because you have an interest in this, you're going to see people line up for and against natural gas as a transportation fuel. What I want to make sure you understand is it can be used in a variety of ways. It can be compressed and burned in a combustion engine. It can be liquefied and burned in a combustion engine. It can be burned at an electric power plant and turned into electricity and put into your car. Or you can strip those four hydrogens off the carbon and have hydrogen for a fuel cell vehicle. So given those different pathways, if you have a cubic foot of natural gas, which of those pathways will take you the farthest? I could compress it and burn it. I could turn it into electricity for my battery plug-in, or I could make hydrogen for a fuel cell. How many of you think you would go farthest on a cubic foot of natural gas if you compressed it and burned it? How many think it's turning it into electricity at a power plant and charging your battery? Okay, how many think it's taking the hydrogen and putting it in a fuel cell? You're right. The last one wins just by a little bit over electricity. So those who picked the battery weren't too far off. Importantly, both of those are over 2 times as efficient and produce half as much CO2 as burning the natural gas. And there's controversy around fracking. There's a lot of advantages, a lot of disadvantages. But I think the reality is natural gas is going to enter into the transportation energy mix, because that arbitrage, that gap between the price of oil at $100 and the price of gas at $4, looks like it's something that's going to be out there for a while. And even today, there's a number of applications of natural gas and transportation that just simply make economic sense. So that's sort of the background on propulsion, but my primary reason to be here today is to talk about something beyond propulsion. It's really to talk about connected vehicles, coordinated vehicles, shared vehicles, autonomous vehicles, how you can tailor the design of those cars, and how you can transform mobility as a result. How many of you have heard of OnStar or Ford Sync? Okay. Those are enabling technologies on cars that allow them to be connected. A connected car communicates with vehicles surrounding it, with locations around it, and with its infrastructure. It allows you to network the car to the cloud. So everything we're doing in the cloud and all of that content has now a path into the car. And all of that taken together allows us to enhance safety, efficiency, and user experiences. This is a mature initiative. There's many different connected vehicle players. You can see all of their logos on this chart. In fact, GM and Ford, together with OnStar and MySync, have over 10 million customers. So connected vehicles are absolutely real. Now, the next building block is what we call the mobility internet, or coordinated vehicles. Now that we have an ability to connect the vehicles and know where they are, and have an ability to know where people are and where they want to go, know the capacity of the roadway versus the number of cars on the roadway, know where the parking status is, we can begin to coordinate the flow of the vehicles and the flow of the people. This uses huge amounts of real-time connectivity data to choreograph those movements of people and goods. I like to call that the mobility internet. It enhances vehicle, roadway, and parking utilization. Very importantly, it enables fewer and less severe crashes. Now, I mentioned that Wall Street Journal article. Really, if you get a chance, you know, I'll look at that tonight, because it's very, very interesting. What's happening in these severe crashes is the driver isn't scrubbing off any speed at all. And we know physics. It's mass and it's acceleration. And if you can have connectivity and cars can communicate with each other, you have a chance to avoid crashes, or minimally reduce the severity of those crashes, prepare the car for a crash by getting those speeds down before things run into each other. With OnStar and stability control technology, what we were able to determine at GM is if you knew the GPS location of two cars, you could calculate their relative to position within a meter. And if you know the wheel speeds and steering inputs on those cars, and you could share them with each other, you could predict where each of these cars would be in the next few milliseconds. And if it looked like they're running into each other, you can try to avoid that, or you could at least reduce that closing of a speed significantly and make the crash less severe. So connected with coordinated becomes very, very promising. It also shortens travel times and makes them more predictable, and it really does for the car what the internet did for the computer. And when you put these two together, connected and coordinated vehicles, you really begin to get a compelling list of benefits for consumers. Crash avoidance, emergency response, stolen car recovery. My daughter's a senior at DePaul University in Chicago, and the other day I get a call, "Dad, I went to go get my car and it's not here." And I'm saying, "Where were you last night and what were you doing?" I just assumed she had parked it somewhere other than what she remembered. But in fact, her car had been taken, and I said, "Well, let's call OnStar." And sure enough, OnStar located her car on the city block. We got the police involved and recovered her car. It was really pretty impressive. Hands-free calling, concierge services. On the business opportunity side, what we're seeing is usage-based automobile insurance. Now, automobile policies cost about $1,000 a car. And if you're willing to let the insurance company have some insight into how many miles you're driving a year, when you're driving those miles, where you're driving those miles, and even in an extreme case, how you're driving those miles, you can get a significant reduction on your insurance policy, hundreds of dollars. A couple of the cars we have in our household go less than 5,000 miles a year, and in each case we get $300 off of our insurance policy because of that. So these benefits are real for companies and customers. Now let's look at this next building block. Sharing, the sharing economy. And a lot of people say, I don't want to share things. But you know there's a growing trend. I'm not sure if we would call it a mega trend yet, where a lot of people are saying access is more important than ownership. So whether it's code, whether it's sharing your lives through Facebook, or your content through YouTube, or your assets through Airbnb, or couch surfing, these things are becoming very real businesses. Sharing or renting products like Zipcar or Rent a Runway for fashion, re-ownership with Craigslist or collaborative lifestyles with Regus in terms of office sharing, it's becoming very, very interesting to see how the recession in part has driven the shared assets and shared property for people to have real businesses off of this. In the shared vehicle world, cars are really parked 85 to 95% of the time. I'll show you a graph a little bit later on for Ann Arbor, but even during rush hour in communities like Ann Arbor, 85% of the cars are parked. And so you have all this capital tied up, your money's tied up in a parked car not serving any value. Plus you have all the land tied up in parking and the congestion that results from people looking for a place to park. Now, if you can serve several different people during a day with a shared vehicle, you can get that utilization up to 60 to 90%. It reduces cost, it reduces time, it reduces congestion, it reduces the hassle of parking and the land use, and it improves the vehicle capital utilization. In Manhattan, only 30% of the people own a car. There are estimates as high as 20% of the miles driven in Manhattan are people looking for a place to park. So there are reasons why shared vehicles are becoming viable. In fact, 25 startup companies have surfaced in the past 10 years. These are the kinds of blips that you look for on the radar screen as a strategist or an innovator to begin to get a sense of whether things might tip. And there's a company called Frost & Sullivan. They do strategic reports for the auto industry. Their estimate is by 2016 in North America, this will be a $3 billion industry. Now take Uber, for example. How many of you have heard of Uber or have had an Uber experience? Uber is a company that basically it's software and a brand. And they'll contract with limousine drivers, people who personally own a limousine, and say, if you're part of our network, we'll connect you to people who want to ride in your car. We'll screen them for their credit cards and all of that stuff so that they're going to pay their fare, and there's not even a transaction when you ride in it. And Uber promises that when you hit their app and request a ride, and they're just now coming to the Detroit area, they'll have a car there in 5 minutes to pick you up. And I've used it in San Francisco. I go out there quite a bit. I have some colleagues that do that. The typical Uber ride in San Francisco, they do get there in 5 minutes. But they also charge about $3 to $4 a mile for the trips that they serve. Now remember that penny and that 10 cents. Uber's got a business here, people who want to use shared vehicles, and they're charging $3 to $4 a mile. And they're growing their business. They're expanding to many cities. That says there's something here from a business standpoint. Okay, now let's shift to autonomous vehicles. And I know some people think that's a dream. You know, it's sort of like the story, a mother was reading a bedtime story to her daughter, and her daughter said, Mommy, do all fairy tales start with once upon a time? And her mom said, no, most of them start with if I am elected. So there are some dreams out there, but autonomous vehicles are real. And I'll make a case to you that they're inevitable. What are they? They operate safely without human control, allowing riders to use their time as they please. That's basically what they are. There's two types. There's self-driving and driverless, and that terminology is important because from a regulatory standpoint, California, Nevada, and Florida have legalized development of self-driving cars on public roads. But in a self-driving car, you still have to sit in the driver's seat. But when you're sitting there, the car is doing the driving, but you're there, you're liable, you have to take over if something comes up. A driverless vehicle is one where it can move totally autonomously with no need for a person as a backup. So a vehicle that drops me off here that's driverless could reposition itself without a person in it and go over to the IOE building and pick up somebody else and take them to downtown Ann Arbor. It's driverless. So that distinction is important. I spend 20% of my time advising Google on their self-driving vehicle program. I want to give you a little bit of history behind how that came about. This vehicle on the upper left is called Boss. It's a Chevy Tahoe. And in 2007, DARPA wanted to have a competition which would stimulate the development of a driverless vehicle for military operations. So these are truly driverless vehicles, no remote control, nobody in them. A GM teamed with Carnegie Mellon University, Volkswagen teamed with Stanford, and there were 85 teams competing. First prize was $2 million. Now 2007 was the last year before GM fell into bankruptcy, and I knew we needed the money, so that's why we entered this competition to try to win the $2 million. But actually, we felt it was going to be a very educational opportunity for our engineers. So we embedded about six engineers from GM Research and Development down in Pittsburgh with the Carnegie Mellon team and built Boss. And Boss won. That's not the story. The story is 85 teams thought they could win this race. 35 of them actually built cars that passed the driver's training test. It's the exact kind of test you would take. Stay within the lines, stop at the stop sign, control your speed, parallel park, all of that stuff. And during that race, there were two spectators. The race was over a three-day period in Victorville, California. You had to go 60 miles, unmanned, obey all traffic laws, and complete that within 6 hours. And two of the spectators were Larry Page and Sergey Brin. They were just there like any other spectator, talking to folks, and they ended up hiring 15 of these engineers on these teams, the young engineers, not just the winning teams, but teams that had good ideas. And they went quiet for about 18 months, and lo and behold, this team of engineers, who ended up being led by the Carnegie Mellon counterpart that I was working with from GM, Chris Urmson, they end up building these Priuses. And what did they do? They, at that time, read the California law, and it said you had to have somebody in the driver's seat. It didn't say you had to touch the steering wheel, the brakes, or the accelerator. So not being an auto company, they just said, what the heck? We'll put this technology on the cars, and we'll start driving them on public roads and begin to see what we can learn. I can guarantee you no auto company would ever have done that because of the liability risks, ever. But this is the nature of innovation. Don't let all these rules box you in to the point where you don't get on with what's really important. So Google's now accumulated nearly 500,000 miles on public roads. They have Priuses and they have Lexuses running around. This is a video shot out of the front of that Prius. Notice the car picks up the truck, it nudges over a bit. This is not contrived. It really did see the deer and slow for the deer. Notice it's dark when it picked it up. It has a laser spinning on top at 10 hertz. It's collecting about 1.5 million measurements per second. Along with that laser, you have radar and cameras. The cameras actually are collecting more data than the lasers. You synthesize all that together and you bounce it against a reference point that was created by driving those routes beforehand with Street View. Now, Street View takes a 360-degree digital picture. This is Lombard Street in San Francisco, by the way. 360-degree digital picture every couple of centimeters. So now you know where you are, you know what you should be seeing, you know what you're seeing with the laser, the radar, the cameras. You fuse all that together, and you give inputs to the wheels and the steering and the braking to drive the car. Now, this is a digital representation of what all those sensors are picking up. it's able to categorize different objects, as whether they're pedestrians or whether they're trees or whether they're cars. By categorizing it, it can then make intelligent decisions, and you just start learning. You just accumulate miles. You discover things that you don't know how to react to. You go back to the lab. You change the software, prove it out, eventually that you can make all of this safe. So the regulators are going to have the burden of proof here has to be safer. NHTSA doesn't have the capacity to determine that. And there's no absolute definition of safe in the auto industry. You have to be safer. This car is capable of being safer in a lot of circumstances, and we're proving that with data, because it can see 360 degrees. Each month when I go out to Mountain View, I spend time in the car. There's a really busy highway called 101 between the airport and Mountain View. And each trip, I'm going farther without touching the steering wheel, the brake, or the accelerator. Some people have gone as far as Lake Tahoe from San Francisco. This is how real this is coming. The people working on the cutting edge of driverless vehicles have publicly stated 3 to 5 years is when the technology will be proven to go anywhere, anytime, on any road. One qualification is snow. My view is once we're there, we'll figure out snow. Even if we have to put little sensors in the paint or something like that, we'll solve snow. By the way, half the cars in the world never see snow. So that's not a showstopper by any means. So why is this so important? Why is it so compelling? Autonomous vehicles will give you more value for your time and your vehicles. Driver distraction is a very serious issue. So I don't want to sound flippant by what I'm going to say next. But as head of R&D at a major auto company, with a lot of people publicly talking about texting and driving and how irresponsible that is, I concluded driving was the distraction. Why else would anyone possibly think it's appropriate to send a text going 70 miles an hour in a 4,000-pound car? Maybe they think the driving is the distraction and the text is more important. So as an innovator, the idea was, well, let's see if we can solve this problem. If they think driving is a distraction, what can we do to eliminate the need to drive? And what we believe is that people really want that time back. Yeah, you'll hear people say, but I like to drive. You don't like to drive when you're stuck in LA freeway traffic in the evening on a hot night. You don't like to drive then. And yes, I accept that. And quite honestly, there were people when Ford was popularizing the car saying, I'd like to ride my horse. They still ride their horse. They still do equestrian. They do horse races. They do backpacking trips with horses. So we're not trying to say you can't drive. We're just simply saying there's a lot of points where that time is really valuable to you. You'd like to use it differently. To prove safer, we're going to have to prove the cars don't crash. So we're going to solve this safety issue. And if a car doesn't crash, it can be significantly lighter. Typical cars are 3,000 to 4,000 pounds. We're talking about classes of vehicles that'll be 500 to 1,000 pounds. Lighter vehicles obviously are much more efficient and importantly are much more conducive to plug-in electric vehicles. The Chevy Volt has a 16 kilowatt hour battery. It's 6 feet long and weighs 390 pounds. It's the size of an offensive lineman. And when you plug it in and charge it up overnight, you go 35 miles. The Leaf has a 24 kilowatt hour battery, and the Tesla Model S, the one that claims the big range, 85 kilowatt hours. That's the issue. The issue is the mass of the vehicle. We're trying to put the battery in much too big of a vehicle for it to make sense. These lighter vehicles, we believe we can get in the range of 5 kilowatt hours. And when you look at lithium ion batteries and Gen 3 technology, 5 kilowatt hour battery will probably be something you can carry and recharge in your apartment. Why is that important? Only 30% of the people in the United States, the most developed country in the nation, park in a garage at home. Everybody else parks in the street or a parking structure. And so the story behind the plug-in electric, it's an important story, but don't conclude, please don't conclude, it's as simple as plugging in your Christmas tree. Because not everybody has a place to plug in, and it's really questionable whether we're going to have electric outlets along every street where every car parks and every parking structure. We've got to get the mass of these cars down. That's why autonomous vehicles are compelling. A lot of companies are working on them, not just Google. Daimler, Volvo, GM, Toyota, Volkswagen, BMW, Bosch, Continental, Delphi. Here at the University of Michigan, you have professors who are participating and leading some of those DARPA Urban Challenge teams. In fact, I've interacted with some of them, and they're so bold as saying, yeah, you consult with Google, but Google doesn't have the only game in town. We've got better ideas. We've got ideas that maybe you don't need to do mapping ahead of time. Maybe you don't need the laser. That's what's going on now. There's a need for this, and the innovators are really running at it hard. The likely timeline is 3 to 5 years. And regulations and liability will gate large-scale commercialization. So as you take courses like the one you're taking here, part of the sensitivity I'm sure that Steve has shared with you is it's not just the engineering challenge. It's about consumers, it's about businesses, it's about society, it's about risk, it's about regulators, it's about how all of that fits together. I think the pathways are going to start in parking lots and on high-speed roads, and we'll come in from those two bookends to get at the toughest challenges, which are city streets at 30 to 45 miles an hour type streets. Features like GM Super Cruiser are coming to market now. And we'll find places to test the full driverless gated communities and campuses. We'll talk about how Ann Arbor might be one of those places near the end. So I mentioned it's lasers, radars, cameras, processors, displays, and actuation for acceleration, braking, and steering. Yes, we're adding cost to the vehicle. But a car that doesn't crash, a car that weighs one-third what a car weighs, has a lot of cost that comes off. And in fact, we believe we can take much more cost off the car by making one that doesn't crash with this technology on it than one that does crash with all of the technology on it that's only used in very rare circumstances. The new Chevy Malibu, by the way, has 9 airbags. That's how far this has come in terms of adding cost for low-frequency events. So this sets up then the next building blocks, and that's the ability to tailor the vehicle design. Driving cycles are things like city driving and highway driving. So when you're in a city, most cities in the world today average 15 to 20 miles an hour. Cars are designed to go 120 miles an hour. But most trips in cities are much slower speed. And duty cycles, most trips are 1- and 2-person trips. 90% of the trips in the United States in cars are 1- or 2-person. But cars are designed for 4 to 6 people. Cars are grossly overspecified relative to how they're used. And for those of you who are inclined toward studying the innovation literature, there's a great writer named Clayton Christensen who wrote a book called Innovator's Dilemma. And the places to look for real business growth opportunities is when you have an overly specified product that's evolved to that high specification over time. By tailoring your design, you can make cars much more efficient in terms of energy, space, time, and cost. Here are some examples. We're going to see an animation of the one on the upper corner called ENV. It's an electrically networked vehicle. The one in the lower right corner is a folding car developed by MIT. Steve mentioned the book called Reinventing the Automobile. Myself and a GM colleague teamed with a renowned professor at MIT named Bill Mitchell. He's an urban planner and architect. He recently passed away, but he's really a phenomenal thinker, and their idea was fold the car so you can park a lot more of them. Here's a few more. This company, Frost & Sullivan, I mentioned before, has done a study looking at auto shows around the world and startup companies. They're anticipating there'll be 150 of these kinds of designs running around by 2020. I want to fixate on the one in the middle. If you read a recent issue of Wired magazine, you would have seen this vehicle called Urbi 2. And Jim Kaur built that structure with 3D printing. And he claims it has the structural integrity of a Formula One race car. It's phenomenal. It weighs 1,000 pounds. Imagine that, an individual using computer-aided design and engineering tools can design a structure that has that capability and then take that digital design to a 3D printer and build it. That was 25,000 hours of printing, so you're not going to mass produce yet. But Moore's Law is still playing out. And as it plays out, this is the kind of stuff that's possible. So let's talk about the transformational potential that we're looking at. You take what we talked about in advanced propulsion, you put it with connected and driverless vehicles, you take that new design DNA, you marry it up with another megatrend, urbanization. 2007 was the year where more than half of the world's population was living in cities. That'll continue to grow. 80% of the wealth will be concentrated in cities. You look at the energy infrastructure and the mobility internet, and you set out to transform mobility. And that's really where we see the world headed. Now, this next video gives you a sense of what that might look like. GM had the rights to the pavilion of the Shanghai World Expo in 2010. We teamed with Segway. We widened the Segway platform, put a rocking gliding chair on it, and asked our designers to design a pod-like machine. So this is a balance machine. It has sensors, which allows it to be self-driven or driverless. And you can platoon them. And we had them in the pavilion. There were 70 million people that visited the pavilion. You can travel as a family in platoons. You can give priority treatment to emergency vehicles moving through traffic because the vehicles are communicating with each other. And then this next moment is very insightful because you can begin to rethink traffic. You can actually have a space-time path for each vehicle through the intersection, just like airplanes have coming into an airport. And so you don't have the delays at the traffic lights. And this is all about connected, coordinated, and shared vehicles. You're connected to the cloud where you're downloading massive amounts of information. I mentioned they're much smaller, so the opportunity for inductive charging for 5 kilowatt-hour batteries becomes much more practical than what we have today. The animation and story behind it involved several characters, one of which was blind, and it highlighted the benefits of this type of mobility system. Now, some of the team members got a little carried away with ideas for parking. If you had a big gulp or a coffee in your car, this might not be as practical as we would like, but it does unleash some of the creativity. The point I'm making with this video is the car is going to be something you wear rather than drive. It's going to become something you park in your closet instead of your garage. That's how this all begins to come together. And that's how it begins to become compelling. It's not one thing. It's a holistic opportunity. One of the most important messages you can take from my lecture today is these challenges that you want to address on sustainability are systems-based challenges. And the innovation is really all around the interfaces of how you put new solutions together. It's not just connected or coordinated or shared or driverless or tailored that makes this possible. It's all of them combined. And when you combine them, you have the ability for better mobility experiences at radically lower consumer and societal costs. That's really what's possible. Now, what I want to do next is give you a sense of the experience you could have. How many of you have a smartphone with you? Okay, mine's in my briefcase. I won't take it out. So now you have one of these. And we've been doing some work with some developers down in Florida. We're calling the system Be Driven. So you've got your Be Driven app. And you hit it. You've already signed up. And you say, I want to book a ride. You scroll down and pick your destination off a menu. It acknowledges you. It knows where you are. It tells you your car will be there in less than 2 minutes. It allows you to track that shared driverless vehicle en route to pick you up. When it arrives, it downloads the security information. It knows you. It's going to charge you for the trip. You don't have to have cash or a credit card. You get into the vehicle. It gives you the details on your trip, how long it's going to take to get to your destination and where you are on that route. It knows you, so it personalizes the pad that's in the vehicle to give you the content that you want. And then you ultimately arrive at your destination. It's that simple. And you might say, well, what might something like this cost? You know, that's one of those really big questions, what might be possible. A lot of the thinking here had its roots in a question my boss, Rick Wagner, asked me when I was at GM. He said, Larry, if we're going to reinvent the automobile today rather than 100 years ago, what would you do different? What would you do different because of the technology that exists, and what would you do different because of the issues that we face? It's kind of the question I asked my wife the other night. She's a little younger than me, and I said, if anything happens to me, are you going to get remarried? She says, I couldn't do that. I care too much for you. I said, well, I'd be gone, and you're still young, and it seems like that makes sense. She says, okay, I'll think about it. And I go, well, if you get remarried, are you going to let this guy have my car? I have a Cadillac XLR. It's kind of my little hobby, pride and joy thing. And she says, that's your car. I couldn't let him have that. And I said, I'd be gone. It'd be in the garage. And she says, okay, I'll think about it. I said, what about my golf clubs? And she said, oh, no, he's left-handed. So you'll never know what you get when you ask a question of what might be possible. But here's what's possible. You could create a shared fleet of connected, coordinated, and driverless tailored vehicles. Most of them would be two-passenger because 90% of the trips are two-passenger trips. Some of them might be six-passenger because sometimes we want to travel as a group or a family. And some of them could be pickup trucks because sometimes we need to haul things. The right vehicle would arrive at your origin when you need it and take you to your destination. So you've hit your app, you've asked for a ride, and it takes you there. You use your time as desired. You're not distracted by having to drive. And you're not hassled by having to park. This vehicle then serves someone else nearby. Why do I know there's somebody else nearby? We've studied these communities. We've looked at the origins and destinations of trips. And I'm sure there's somebody nearby that's going to want to have a ride. So you minimize those empty miles. And then the shared fleet size is there to ensure the responsiveness and spontaneity that people enjoy by owning their own personal car. And your ride then arrives in a few minutes because we've sized that fleet properly. And so we look at this in really detailed in a number of different places. I'm going to go through a couple of quick case studies. Ann Arbor. Here is it's a medium-sized U.S. city. It's a lot like Rochester, New York, Austin, Texas, Columbus, Ohio, Salt Lake City, Sacramento, all have characteristics like Ann Arbor. And what we're doing is competing, we're introducing a new mode where we would compete with personally owned cars. So just a couple facts around this area. It includes this database, included Ypsilanti and Chelsea as well as Ann Arbor, 285,000 people in 130 square miles, owning 200,000 cars. 120,000 of those cars are typically used just within this area. They don't go outside the area. Those vehicles average 3.7 trips per day with 1.5 people at 30 miles an hour, and each trip is about 8 miles. And the vehicles are used about 60 minutes a day, or 4% of the day. So what have we learned? We concluded that 18,000 driverless connected shared vehicles serving those internal Ann Arbor trips would cost each subscriber about $3 a day, that the trip request would be met within 2 minutes, and that there'd be 0.02 empty miles for every mile loaded. Now let's look at those a little more detailed. We used methods from operations research, network methods and queuing methods. If any of you are from the IOE department, that's actually my home department here at University of Michigan. AAA does an annual study of what it costs to own and operate a car. I've shown it. If your car goes 10,000 miles a year or 15,000 miles a year, that's either 75 cents a mile or 59 cents a mile. Now remember, keep that penny and dime in mind. If we use conventional cars and just simply shared them and coordinated them and they were driverless, we could get the cost down to 41 cents a mile. If we tailored the design, recognizing that 90% of the trips are one and two person trips, we could get that down to 15 cents a mile. Now that's cost. 80% reduction in cost for someone who has, let's say, a second car living in Ann Arbor, using it less than 10,000 miles a year. That's 60 cents a mile in cost savings versus a penny a mile or a dime a mile. Now let's look at Manhattan. This is a different competitive set. We're competing here against yellow taxi cabs. There's 1.6 million people in 23 square miles of Manhattan, and they make 410,000 taxi trips a day. And they average 1.4 people, 5 minute wait time, so you go out and you hail a cab. These trips go about 2 miles. You travel about 11 minutes at 11 miles an hour. And then you have about 6/10 of an empty mile for each loaded mile. So compare that to that 0.02 that we had before. And there's 13,000 taxis. And we did the analysis for Manhattan, and a mix of 2- and 4-person vehicles, 9,000 of them versus 13,000, would reduce the typical fare from $7 of cost to $1. Your wait time for hailing one to a minute from 5 minutes, and the empty miles from 0.6 to 0.05. So these are pretty compelling numbers. And it has to do with the fact that the vehicles are optimally dispatched. And even if they're 80% utilized, and in the Ann Arbor example, you had 18,000 of them, you have about 4,000 unallocated in 140 square miles, roughly. And you spread them out, and there's an empty one a tenth of a mile away from every destination. That's how they respond so quickly. Plus, you have all the ones that are about to complete a trip that can be allocated. That's how this works. So it's coordination and connectivity, and it's sharing the vehicle, so it's getting utilized fully during the day, and then it's making it driverless so you don't have to have labor costs to reposition the empty vehicle. And given that it's driverless, you tailor the design to match the trip. And when you put all that together, you get compelling metrics on cost. But the story doesn't end there. These numbers don't include parking costs, but more importantly, they don't include your time. So how much do you value your time? That's the question. And that's not an exact science. When big projects are being studied to reduce congestion, let's say you're going to build a new interstate somewhere, the Department of Transportation says you should use 60 to 80% of the median income as a basis for valuing time to justify the benefits costs of that project. But let's look at a few different metrics. Let's say you're moving around at 30 miles an hour and you make minimum wage of $77.25. You're valuing your time at 24 cents a mile. Let's say you're a median income person in the U.S. making about $50,000 or $25 an hour. That's 83 cents a mile. Let's say you're really one of these lucky people who are in the 90th percentile income at $200,000 at 30 miles an hour is $3.33 an hour, a mile. And I said if 10% of the miles could make a dime, 10 cents, you'd make $30 billion. 10% of the people make more than $200,000, and those people value their time at more than $3.33. How many of you think there's a business opportunity here by serving these people? I think so. Now let's go a little bit further. When you go to a movie, oftentimes you'll spend $10 for 2 hours of entertainment. At 30 miles an hour, that $5 per hour equates to 17 cents a mile. So people are really spending real money to be entertained at almost twice that 10-cent bogey that I put out there. My daughter went to the Tigers opening game and her ticket was $40 and she was entertained for 3 hours. That's $13 an hour or 43 cents a mile. And even if you buy internet service on a flight at $5 for a 3-hour flight, that's 6 cents a mile. The point I'm making here is this $300 billion at 10 cents should feel like a chip shot. If you're selling miles, trips, and experiences, and you can get that customer with your brand, and you can get them the content or the experience that they want, whether it's entertainment, whether it's productivity, whether it's simply sleeping, you have a chance to change the game on the business model. So I think that transformational change is really imminent. We've got 6 building blocks when they come together, offer a solution. Every one of those are viable. They exist today. Maybe the one with the greatest reach is driverless, and I think there's a compelling case to make that it's inevitable and the technology will be proven in 3 to 5 years. So let's talk about transformational change, because after all, my first chart was Carl Benz, and that was 1876, and I made the case that the industry has not transformed. Boy, photography has transformed in that 125 years. Telephone systems transformed, air travel transformed from propellers to jets, pharmaceuticals have transformed. Why hasn't this auto industry transformed? Transformational change fundamentally alters an entire system and redefines how it behaves. It's disrupted, it's very hard to forecast, and it results from a combination of technology and business model innovation, and is driven by value creation focused on these compelling experiences. You have to change the system. You can't just change the parts. It hasn't happened because we have a highly complex system today of vehicles, roads, fuel stations, traffic laws, and trained drivers. The customer value comes from integrating all of that. I'll be frank, to conclude that we're going to solve the sustainability issue with automobiles because we have better lithium-ion batteries is very myopic, and I'll even go on record as saying it's naive. The customer has to want that battery in their car and want to recharge frequently and prefer that experience to stopping at a gasoline station once a week for 3 to 5 minutes to get a 400-mile range. You've got to understand there's huge inertia in this system today with multiple objectives, strong vested interests, addressed with individual technologies rather than a system of technologies. We tend to look at transportation separate from housing, separate from energy, separate from agriculture, when in fact when we live our daily lives, all of those things come together to make our lives better. And you have these ingrained business models. If I'm right, and if this transitions to selling trips, miles, and experiences rather than selling cars, gasoline, and insurance companies, how many of you think conventional automotive OEMs like GM are going to feel comfortable about that? How many of you think Allstate or Progressive Insurance are going to feel comfortable about cars no longer getting in crashes? How many of you think ExxonMobil is going to be excited about the idea that 90% of the trips could be served by a vehicle that weighs 1,000 pounds and is electrically driven and is 10 times as efficient as a combustion vehicle? Now, Steve may have touched on this in your lectures. When you burn a gallon of gasoline in your car, I'll let you think about it. What percent of the BTUs in that gallon of gasoline are moving you? How many of you think half the BTUs in that gallon of gasoline are moving you to your destination? How many of you think it's 10%? It's 1%. When you combust gasoline, 25% turn the wheels, 75% gets lost as heat. People weigh 150 pounds, a car weighs 3,000 to 4,000 pounds. We're sitting here saying we have a sustainability issue with oil and transportation, and as engineers, we're accepting that the system uses just 1% of a gallon of gasoline's energy to move the person. There's enormous opportunity here, but this transformational change gets stymied because of these strong vested interests. They're very, very real. My message, though, is that roadway transportation is now ripe for this transformational change. Very, very ripe. And it's a significant business opportunity that's going to pull that through and get it over the goal line. And a compelling benefit for people living their everyday lives. Believe me, when I go from North Campus to Main Campus to give a lecture, and I'm driving my car, and I have to buffer that trip with 30 minutes, and I'm dealing with the anxiety of whether I'm going to make that park, get that parking spot and get to that lecture on time, that's not a good experience compared to the option of hitting an app, having that vehicle show up at the IOE building in 2 minutes and dropping me right off at my destination downtown, knowing that that trip was done with zero emissions, not fumbling with cash or credit cards, and doing what I want during the ride. That's what is within our grasp. So it's pretty exciting. And what's interesting about this is when you study disruptive change, let's take photography. Kodak, they invented the digital camera. But think how different the business model was when I was growing up with photography. I'd go to the drugstore and buy a roll of film. None of you have probably ever done this. I'd take that home and put it in my camera, and I would take 36 pictures or 24 pictures. Hopefully they were good. I'd take that roll of film back to the drugstore, drop it off, and they would say, come back in a couple of days and pick up your pictures. My third trip to the drugstore was to get my pictures. I'd look at my pictures, and two-thirds weren't any good. And now, with digital photography, you don't go anywhere, and you can take 5,000 pictures, crop them, highlight them, change them, throw them away. Unbelievable disruptive change, and the company that invented that couldn't get in front of the business model change. It was remarkable. So this disruption has huge opportunities for, again, your cohort group. It's also hugely threatening to people who are ingrained in these incumbent companies. Now, very good news here is that our university is positioning to be on the cutting edge of all of this. It's about to be announced that we're creating a Michigan Mobility Transformation Center. It's really marrying up the College of Engineering with the University of Michigan Transportation Research Institute. We want to lead the convergence of connected and automated mobility systems. In addition to UMTRE and the College of Engineering, we have the Energy Institute, the Architecture and Urban Planning School, and the SMART team. The mission we've crafted for this, it's safe, affordable, and efficient automated movement of people and goods anywhere, anytime. Real important. Let's keep these goods and people connected. Now, when that vehicle drops me off, it may not pick up a person. It might pick up your pizza and bring it to your dorm. Or it could pick up your recycled waste and take it to the recycling center. I work out of my home office quite a bit because of the different jobs that I have. It's interesting. The UPS driver shows up. Later in the day, the FedEx driver will show up. He happens to be left-handed, by the way. And later on, the mail person will show up. And they come to my door and they give me something that weighs a pound or less. You don't think we can't come up with a better goods movement system than what we have? Trucks typically carry loads of 50 to 80,000 pounds. And we're carrying about 2 pounds of vehicle for every pound of goods that we're shipping. Just like with the people movement. So we want to keep that together. We think that's going to be very, very innovative mobility systems for people and goods. We think this is going to be compelling to consumers, not just lower costs, but we'll give you your time back. We'll give you experiences as you move around. We think it is a business that can be profitable at large scale, and we think it'll be safer, environmentally sustainable, and socially progressive to enhance accessibility. People under 16 who don't have driver's licenses now are going to be able to be moved around in new and innovative ways. People who are 70 years old are as risky as drivers as teenagers, and they're going to be able to move around. People with disabilities are going to be able to move around in new ways. The goals that we're setting is to demonstrate a mobility system with order of magnitude improvements in all these metrics. Get this thing designed and engineered and proof of concept in 4 years and run it as a 4-year demonstration is what we're striving to do between the College of Engineering and UMTRE. Our goals are things like major motor vehicle fatalities and injuries, reduce that by a factor of 10. Energy consumption for moving goods and people by a factor of 10. Carbon emissions, and then open up new transportation startups and new businesses. We'll know we're making progress if we're seeing significant reductions in user time and cost, reductions in freight cost, better utilization of roadway capacity, reduced need for parking, better physical proximity of services, and better land use. We have a series of foundational actions. Some of these will be workshops. I'm hoping some of you might be inclined to be interested in participating in some of these workshops, or they could be capstone programs. But for example, if you knew it was inevitable that cars could drive themselves and wouldn't crash, how would you design the car? I'm quite interested in that. How many parts would be in your design? Would you even have a steering wheel? Would you have brake pedals and accelerators? Would you have an instrument panel? How many airbags do you think you'd have in your car? What do we think that would cost? We really want to engage the diversity of the students here, undergraduate, graduate, students from all over the world, and innovate around these designs. We want to engage the faculty in these kinds of workshops, and we want to engage the businesses that are a very important part of Southeast Michigan, some of which are startups and are going to ride that innovative curve, some of which are threatened if this disruptive change plays out. Secondly, we want University of Michigan in Ann Arbor to be a nation-leading connected and automated vehicle test environment. We want to be able to rapidly and cost-effectively learn with these technologies. Large-scale data collection capabilities, managing that data in a safe environment. what we're about to announce, and again, I'm going a little risky here because I'm not sure I can even talk publicly about that, but you're part of the team, is the approval of a test track just off of Plymouth Road between Huron Parkway and Green behind the Umphrey building. And it's going to be a pretty slick facility that will allow us to test your ideas and concepts on a simulated roadway environment with intersections and roundabouts and furniture along the road and traffic signals and stop signs so that we can go from conceptual idea, small-scale testing in a lab, out to a place and run it in a real environment, know it's safe enough to then deploy in the Ann Arbor community. That's what we're hoping to be able to do. Here's a drawing of that test track. We'll have 1,000-foot straightaway, and this grid traffic merges. And then we want to build on what's already going on here. It's a safety pilot. Umphrey really accomplished something very, very unique in being the winner of a competition selected by the Department of Transportation to lead a safety pilot here in Ann Arbor. You may not be aware of it, but there's more than 4,000 drivers, everyday people in Ann Arbor. 3,200 of their vehicles have been equipped with communications technology, transponders, and GPS. And we're now running a real safety pilot of connected vehicles, communicating with each other, communicating with some of the roadway infrastructure to understand the reliability of the communication systems with hills and weather, to understand cybersecurity better, and to understand whether we really can improve safety with these technologies. So what we want to do is position the university to get to the next level, getting this test track in place, keeping these test pilots engaged, and having a chance to really make this the go-to place for developing these technologies. Then we'll incorporate all of this with what's going on with intelligent vehicle energy systems in the test environment, and then get the policies and principles for guiding this 21st century mobility with conferences, land use policies, and then finally convene that broadened constituency, business forums, and the Michigan industry leadership. The bottom line here is that the university is committed to mobility research, teaching, and demonstration. They want to be centered on connected and autonomous vehicles, responsive to the local industries and governments, putting the world's best facilities together from idea all the way out into on-road, real-world learning, and being able to demonstrate these automotive systems to learn fast, efficiently, and cut the lead time down and prove this vision out. So let me stop there. It's an awful lot of information, I recognize that, but we have a little bit of time left for some questions about all of this. Again, Steve, you might need to help me with the questions.